glad to introduce our first speaker for today. I'll tell you a little bit about him. He is the Senior Vice President of UX Design at MakeMyTrip. He is also the founder and curator of DesignUp. And today, he's going to present us with a session called Designing Without Borders. So everyone, please welcome Jay Dutta. Okay.
Hello, Chennai. Can you hear me at the end? Mr. 501, great, thank you. That's a pretty full house, and thank you so much for coming, and thank you for inviting me. My pleasure, and for organizing SaasD. I think the more events, the merrier, and I think that's great that we start here. So I'm usually known as JD, or in the Instagram or the Twitter world, it's more JD all caps. I am a typographer by training, so that's where my JD all caps comes from, though I hate all caps and I don't use it much. Let me just see. Some glitches are to be, I think you might not be connected to the thing, yeah. Sure. No, I'm good. Can you hear me at the back? Not enough echo and all? It's okay, right? Great. So I've been recently working with a few companies last 4 to 5 years, if I think about it. Adobe, which is a very prosumer kind of company, very close to what you do. Not corporate, but users use those products for a very, very long time. I mean, many of you use it for like days. So I probably worked on 5 versions of Illustrator, several versions of InDesign, none on Photoshop, but somewhere if you look back, you'll find my name on that list. Again, these users resist change, very unlike some of the other apps that we talk about, because you're used to using Illustrator in a certain way. You don't want it to change too frequently, too much, all of that. Now I work for MakeMyTrip, before that for a short time in Flipkart. There it's a very different thing. It's for consumers. It may be the same person as a prosumer and as a consumer. Infrequent use, extremely distracted, open to new things. They're looking for some, like they're getting bored. They want to sort of just look at a few things, browse a few things, minimal learning. My route to MakeMyTrip was through a VC. I used to work with a VC called SAIF Partners, short for SoftBank's Asia Infrastructure Fund. And that's a very, very different ballgame. So I didn't even compare it. There's no point in comparing that to any of that. And I run a conference called DesignUp Conference, and that's a very community thing. It's more annual, but there are lots of little events happening around. Some of you might have attended. It's a very focused one, very, very, at runtime, like today, everything is happening. Everything will happen here at runtime. And again, you'll go back, you'll probably find some inspiration, some of that will be actionable, and that's what probably people come for. This is my team at MakeMyTrip. We call it NH44 because we have a team in Delhi and in Bangalore, and NH44 connects both of them. And every time you talk about MakeMyTrip and they say, hey, I have a problem with a refund, so we said, let's call it something else. That's the other reason why, kind of, right? We also have some very fancy stickers, like your fancy posters out here. And we have a blog where we talk mostly about traveling because we all love to travel. And how did we hack our travel journeys? That's probably what we talk about more. And today I'm going to talk to you about designing or design without borders. It's a pet subject which has been in my head for some time, and I thought this is probably a good point to talk about that. I'm going to be talking about borders, some of the paradoxes and ironies, and biases. And I think I'm not going to talk about cognitive biases. I'm sure you have that in your head, you know about it, psychologists call it and all of that. I'm also going to be talking about breaking some of those borders and de-blurring some of those boundaries. So first, borders. North, south. We all put things into some sort of borders and frames. Left, right, to me. It may be different to you. You will have north of the wall and south of the wall. You could have other things like Man City and Man U. By the way, I used to live in Manchester and I was a Man U fan, but I know a lot of Man City fans and we would get along well, okay, kind of once in a while. You have left and right, left of center, right of center, extreme left. It can keep going on, you know, you kind of, and at some point of time, this kind of starts to divide and In the same way, in our world, you could also kind of look at something like that. For example, there are Luddites who will refuse to use technology. There are people who will happily navigate the dark web. There are hacker activists, and there are people like us somewhere in between. So there is a whole bunch of things in some ways. There is some in politics, there is there in work, and some boundaries divide us, some boundaries unite us, so on. So I think with every choice that we make, I think either we are reinforcing those borders, we are reinforcing those boundaries, or we are breaking those boundaries. Sometimes the choices that you make are not really apparent to you. It's just you made it, you did it kind of thing. But it probably in hindsight makes more sense. So here's a question for all of you. Are all of you here designers or are there non-designers? Let's see who are the non-designers. Okay, great. So where do you come from? I mean, what's your, which part of the boundary are you in? Okay. Product managers, almost everyone? Anyone not a product manager, not a designer? Okay. Great. Excellent. So this one is for designers and non-designers as well. What's one activity that all designers usually start with? Not for you, maybe, but for most people. Any guesses? Sorry? Results? Okay. Research, okay, sure, that's one thing, yeah. Inspiration, yeah. Okay, problem. Okay, sketching. So I think the moment you take it on to the, I mean, yes, all of that, and the moment you take it onto your machines, onto some format, you define the boundaries, you define the formats of those things. You say, well, do you want it an A4 letter, 12 feet wall, 17 feet wall, web, mobile? But you define a frame for it. There is always a frame within which things happen kind of thing. And part of my talk is going to be how do we think beyond that frame kind of thing, right? That's what you start with. You start with frames of all sorts kind of thing. And it's not just UX. I mean, you could say UX, but you could say it's for almost everything that we mostly do. We have a frame, and everything happens within a frame. It's actually quite ironic because at the other end, we are talking about seamless sort of experiences. Have you read this book called No UI, or this whole philosophy around there should not be any UIs, there should not be buttons, it should all be very seamless. We're talking about IoT. We're talking about voice, we're talking about, yes, forget all those frames kind of thing, forget those glass. So if glasses rule the world, that's not the idea that we want. At the other end, we are talking about form factors and boxes. Even if you want to move into multiple scalable form factors, you're always talking about boxes. So let me jump into paradoxes and ironies and talk a little more about that. This is one. It's ironical that we have 3x more mobiles than toilets, and this is an old number. It's probably about 5 years old, so this number may have skewed even more because I think the toilets are still not being built at the same pace as mobiles are being bought and used and recycled. Here's another one for you. You have 17 million child laborers, and you have about 200 million unemployed adults. Now, that the moment you reach that number, you start to think in terms of, hey, hang on, what's the problem here? No one told you that there was a problem, but data tells you there is a problem kind of thing, right? We have 1% of the world's automobiles and 15% of the world's accidents, which is actually very weird kind of if you think about it. 740,000 doctors estimated, 200 million temples. There is faith kind of course, when their doctors don't reach. That's 270x if you look at that difference. And again, these are some of them are 2013, 2015, 2016, but not more than 2016. This probably is a huge differential if you think about it. 8,547x of per capita and donations at Tirupati. Kind of, I mean, this thing. So I think paradoxes, when you think about paradoxes, they or ironies, they are like creativity. You have different things, you have different data points, and suddenly when you see a relation between them, you say, wow, I didn't think about that in that way. I didn't think about that is a relation actually. So, you know, very disparate kind of things, and you say, wow, there's a connection there between these two. but that is an opportunity to be solved actually. Let me talk about biases. And as I said, I will not talk about biases from the reference of your psychological things, anchoring or, you know, confirmation bias, etc. You know all of those kind of, I'm pretty sure. I'm going to talk about biases about people and about teams and about working for people. So I think we typically design for people like us and we typically hire people like us. And that is an unconscious bias if you think about it. So for example, we would hire people very often with designer. So actually I interviewed someone about 3 years ago at Flipkart. And I thought this was like the most awesome dude because he looked the designer part completely kind of. He had the right glasses, he had the right beard, he had the right this thing. And he failed at the whole process, but he was the quintessential designer as you see. So we read Medium, very often men, NID, IIT. So you have an affinity for the college that you went to. We hire people like that. We will design for people like us again. So these are mostly urban users kind of who we design for. Again, most people, we understand each other, so it's almost like us, kind of, right? And, or a global version of us. We are probably comfortable with a global version of us as well, kind of, whether it's a LinkedIn or an Uber, Ola Uber kind of thing. Ola Uber is actually used as one word, so that's another interesting one. But we are not very comfortable designing for the desi or the localized, Indianized version of us. Which are some of these. So I've worked with a few of these as a part of my VC thing. But Hello English and ShareChat, how many have you heard of or used ShareChat? Have you used ShareChat? Anyone here? So I was given the task of trying to clean up ShareChat. And I said, it doesn't need any cleaning up. It doesn't need a Western educated designer like me to tell it what it is good or bad. It doesn't. It's doing well, leave it as it is kind of thing. Because I just don't understand that paradigm. But that paradigm is understood by millions of more than people like me. And I'm probably a very small number like you all. We all are a part of a very small number kind of thing. So when I joined MakeMyTrip a few years ago, 2.5 years ago almost, people said, you must be joking. That's such a bad app, such a crappy app kind of thing. Actually, I had the same thought. I mean, like, should I join it? And I had this thing. And that was a bias in my head saying, but the thing is that if it is crappy, then you need to make it better. So that's probably the idea kind of. This comes from a very old Honda ad. And Honda was talking about diesel engines in that context. And I'm talking about it could be applied to anything. You hate something, you change it. That's the best way of doing things kind of, right? So we changed it. And it's last year and a half, I think it has gone through a whole number of sort of visually. The question is, what is better then? That's probably the other question that it. Because this appeals to our Western sensibilities again, saying it's clear, it's ordered, it's structured, there is nice type, there is a lot of white space, all of that. But the question, I would probably not have asked this question maybe 10 years ago, but today I keep asking that what does better actually mean? Am I designing for my peers or am I designing for my users? That's the other big question kind of thing, right? So we have a system, Cosmos, which is the design language and all of that, which is work in progress. It's getting there. It's not as I want it to be, but it's work in progress. I think what is better is the philosophy around which it is built. It's built to put my back into MakeMyTrip, because MakeMyTrip, like any other app, was becoming very impersonal. But I think somewhere you invest time trying to search for a flight somewhere. Can I put those things back? That's probably the simple thing. Even beyond me, beyond some of the many people who are there, if the philosophy lives on that this is what we want to do, then that is better. Okay. So this is what I was talking about. Designing for users first, businesses next. Because very often we design for businesses first, peers as much, and yeah, by the way, users. Very often when I ask people, like, did you go for that user research? And they say, well, no, product managers came and told me, or, you know, market research guys came and told me. Like, why were you not there? That was the question. And people say, hey, well, you know, I did this because my job is only to make the road. So I'm like, what about the edges of the road? Who makes those edges? Like, but I don't know, mine was to A to B, that was it kind of thing, right? So this is again the borders really, where we say this is my job, this is your job, this is I won't do that kind of thing, right? And we talk about I'm a full stack designer. The question is, how full is your stack actually? That's part of the stack kind of. What is a full stack actually? Like, pick any three. What about this, I mean, that also is a stack. maybe it's not vertical, but that's horizontal, but that's the stack as well, right? I think the stacks are changing. Don't kind of keep your kind of thing on what stack it is. The question is not about stack. The question is about connecting the dots, really, kind of thing. So I used to complain, for example, there aren't enough good, like there aren't enough like world-class design events happening out of India. And this was my pet complaint for many years. 2016, MP Ranjan, my mentor from NID, who is from Chennai, in his very weird Hindi, Chennai Hindi, would say, "Tu kya karega?" kind of thing. I'm not saying the same way that he would say. And when he passed away in 2016, it just kind of, it clicked in me. What am I going to do about it? I can keep complaining, like all of us, roads are bad, this is bad. What am I going to do about it? The response was, and this is again a wonderful quote by a guy called Charles Handy. Charles Handy is your management guru, but he writes some wonderful books on paradoxes and a whole lot of management theories, but very, very humane. He's a very different kind of a management writer. My response was, DesignUp's the first one. We did the boot up. We, of course, did. We had a very small gathering in a tiny space, 230 people, completely kind of packed up. Great speaker lineup, 2 days. And we kind of did it with a scale up the year after, 2017, which is we had about 34 speakers. And 2018, we did it in Chennai. We were actually here. We were in Singapore. We had Alan Cooper, a whole bunch of people from across the world. We had a whole drum jamming session, which we all enjoyed, I hope. And kind of we have grown up in about 3 years. We have about, last year was 780 people roughly, if I'm not mistaken. And we got the thing around 20 most exciting design events in the world last year, year before actually. So I think it came from the response of like, my response is not going to be tweets and words and I'm not going to argue with someone. My response has to be to make something and put it out there in the world. That probably has to be our response. Your response has to be, you're good with something. You're good with maybe drawing, with visuals, with something else. That has to be your response kind of, right? So when I look at that stack, when we do this, I think the stack has the least is the designer and the everything else is the last kind of thing. We are probably negotiating. We have to file GSTs. We have to keep negotiating with people on spaces. We have to do 20 other things. I think it just helps us grow. It helps us grow as an individual. It just stretches you kind of in a different way. Increasingly, when I think about it, what is good design and what is our role? I think our role is to create those ecosystems within which good design can actually happen. Good, thoughtful design can happen. And this is what I think if you're conversing with management theory and some of the people like Stephen Covey, et cetera, how do you grow your circle of influence? I mean, currently that's your job, your career. Maybe you are influencing your team. Are you influencing your group, your company, your clients, your industry, your peers, your tribe, your design school? What are you influencing and what are you doing about it? That's probably the question. This I just put in because it just occurred to me. This is actually a wonderful example of that. This is from Japan. And this is probably not the best example, but it's a great example. They designed the bullet train, 1964. To this date, zero accidents, never a failure. This one essentially says that there are two kinds of classes. If you are in the fastest, which is called Nozomi, your car will stop there. If you are in the next four, your car number will stop here. Not just that, you have different gradations. So you really don't want to step outside the yellow line, and you can't pull your luggage on the yellow line because it's kind of mottled, right? And if you work backwards, so you design the train, you design the tracks, you design the platform, you design even the approach, because the approach is where there will be most disabled cars, where you will have the first class, they will actually be close to the lifts. So the escalators kind of thing. So you actually started designing one thing and you ended up designing the whole ecosystem around which everything works. So I think that's the beauty of it. And this probably is an example how 10 has exactly stopped at 10. Since 1964, the greatest accident they had was this went off by 2 feet once. And the guy was not sacked. He didn't commit harakiri either. But they said, oh, well, that's a human error. That guy went off to sleep maybe. And maybe we should have two drivers so that it never goes off by 2 feet. That's exactness kind of, which I'm like blown away by. So I've been talking about that. And I'm sure this is probably what you guys keep thinking about. I'm sure you pester your manager. You pester him. talking about what's my growth path? Am I growing as a designer? I think growth is not your manager's responsibility, not your company's responsibility. Part of it, and huge part of it, is your responsibility, kind of, right? And part of it is not growth inside the company, the growth as an individual. Our careers are extremely long. We'll be in our careers like maybe 30 years more for many of you that I see. Maybe there's a 30, 40 year career kind of, and things will keep changing. It's going to keep changing much more rapidly than our parents. Our parents, our grandfathers, maybe never even changed a company. Forget kind of another career kind of thing. And in that, maybe they had 3 promotions in their entire 30 year kind of career there. We are going faster, much faster. So once you get promoted to the top level, our CEO has been the CEO for donkey's years, and that's the only position that he can have. There's no promotion for him, right? So it's that, you hit that. So I'm going to talk a little about that. Because I talked about boundaries and borders and all of that, I think it's okay to create borders that discipline you. So for example, if you say, I'm going to go to bed early tonight because I have to run in the morning tomorrow, that's great, create those boundaries. At the same time, recognize and break the boundaries which are kind of hindering you. Are you not talking to the PMs, or you're not talking to the devs, or you're not having lunch with someone else? Are you a little shy of interviewing someone? What is the boundaries which is in your head? I can't do this. Maybe I should not take the risk of doing this. I quit Flipkart, a very cushy job, when at a very late stage in life, and I said I'm going to start my own. And that was a very stupid mistake. Don't make stupid mistakes like me. But I think on the second thoughts, I think it was a great thing, because that landed me in a VC. That completely changed the trajectory of my life. So risks at any point in time, great, break those kind of thing. We are extremely focused on getting. What do we get? Likes, upvotes, salary kind of things, increments, ratings, recommendations, etc. We, especially increasingly our generations, the question is, what are we giving? Because it's all a factor of value. What you get is a factor of value, really. What value do you give? What value do you bring? And the biggest thing is, if I look at, you will probably give a lot of time in your work because that pays you. So that's probably a direct correlation. But if you look at your community, school, neighborhood, city, strangers, et cetera, these are not what you get paid for, but can you still give? That is a big question that you should ask yourself. Because unless you give, you cannot grow. That's a fact of life. Take it kind of thing. Naresh Narasimhan, an architect, spoke about this in 2017, design, if not, that's the wrong number there. And he talked about being a citizen, not a consumer. I pay taxes, I want this from the government. I do this, I'm giving time, I want this from the company. I want free food and maybe some Maggie packets as well. I'm giving this, I want this. The question is, what can you give even without kind of getting? That's probably being a citizen kind of, really. Orders are given, tasks are given, goals are given. I think what you have to do is to take more responsibility and give more out, give more value out. That's the only way that your circle of influence will grow, and you will start to influence maybe your team, maybe your groups, maybe your boss, maybe your peers, maybe people in Chennai and much, much more beyond. That's the only way that you can do that. And remember, design can be many things. A designer can be what you want to do, just like a developer can be, just like a differently abled person can be. It's just what is limiting you is your boundaries that you draw kind of thing. Be what you want to be. There's nothing, no level. So the question I leave you with really is, think about this when you, maybe tomorrow, Sunday, maybe in the years to come, maybe the week when it begins. The question is April 2029, where will you be? Technology will change a lot, things will change. How does everything matter kind of thing? 2034, 2039, how will that pan out? Remember this one, that with every choices, you're either creating or reinforcing or breaking boundaries. So take those choices which help you break boundaries. Give back, you will get more in return. So Andy Grove, the very famous CEO of Intel, once said, the paranoid survive. And this was held as like the Bible kind of thing, or kind of a biblical saying in the valley. I think it has changed to some extent. What I would say is, the curious survive. Be curious, be giving. That's the best way of doing it. So thank you, and stay curious. So questions, or we?
Yeah, we have time for questions. Yeah. So if anyone has any questions, they can shoot them right now. Yes, please.
So you have been working for the product companies, the enterprise, the consumer, and the VC as well. In your perspective, how is working with VC as a contribution as a designer in VC is different from contribution as a designer in a product, I mean in the consumer versus the enterprise?
So to repeat the question, if I got it right, is how different is it working for the VCs versus the product, service, tech? The role of a designer you're talking about. Okay, so role of a designer in a VC is, I think I was one of the very early ones in, at least in Asia, I would say, kind of, not outside, there have been a lot of designers in the VCs. It's a very different sort of a role in the sense that you are advising, you're not doing things. Typically, a designer does things, produces artifacts, produces services, systems, etc. In this case, you are being a mentor, a friend to the CEOs, the startup guys. Some of them will be very, very early stage startups. There would be people like Urban Clap and Rivigo. Rivigo is like a trucking company. So it's like a very different company entirely. And their needs are extremely different. So part of it is, like a designer, you have to understand the needs. What is the needs of company A versus B, and where can you plug in design? What you need to go there with is a bigger understanding of design with a big D. It's not graphic, it's not necessarily marketing, and it is also graphic and also marketing and also UX and also something else. So you are kind of really rethinking design from a very, very big perspective. The difference here is that you are advising these founders, CEOs, etc., but they may or may not take your advice. So that's the other part of it. So you're not really implementing, but you are advising, and it's up to them to take that advice. You're also helping them build teams, and that could be a good way of kind of saying, given that structure of this company, how does that team function really? One of the things which happened, two things which I did while being in the VC, which actually helped them a lot. One was to really having open door sessions, mentoring sessions with designers in the VCs or with anyone, any entrepreneur who wants to chat. Because that helped them clarify a very critical area, which is a product market fit. Because very often entrepreneurs will go in and say, this is my idea and this is the awesome idea, I'm going to do it. But they don't understand the product market fit part until they start losing money or bleeding money, kind of. This was one area, so that open door policy, the thing, open door discussions really helped. The second is internships. So while I decided to get a bunch of interns who I would then place it to the various companies. And the thing is that this intern is probably the very first designer in that company, and the intern also is a very young designer. So it's like, how do you come to grips? You need a mentor. There's no mentor in that company. So I would be the mentor for them, and they would help each other out as a group. So this would be the ways in which, hope that answers.
So yeah, anyone has any other questions?
Anyone this side? Like the question?
Oh yeah, we have someone.
Yeah.
Seeing like a lot of B2C, basically, I would say e-commerce, literally, a lot of dark patterns introduced, especially when you are on the payment gateway. They make sure that the conversion happens. Mm-hmm. So, as an ethical designer, what are your takes? I mean, how you should ensure that, though we have been like a lot of pushed by marketing and all to like make sure that conversion happens, but then make sure that the dark pattern is not being introduced there and then should be ethical enough. So, what are your thoughts on it?
So I think, again, as a, it really depends. So once you come in at a junior level in a company, I think you could have a lot of say, you could say a lot of things, but you might not be heard right the way in the top. But when you reach a certain level, at least you can talk about these to your CEO. And you say, this is what I don't believe in. I'm not complaining about a person or a particular department, but I'm saying this is just not wrong from a user perspective kind of thing, right? And chances are that they will listen because they also know that this is not the right thing, kind of. Example I'll give you is this, that in MakeMyTrip, we used to have something like an auto. So for example, if you insurance was ticked yes, so by default you would go kind of saying that this is ticked yes. Obviously people didn't like it, and that's fairly obvious, but it needs a champion inside to say, no, it's not good, it's not right, let's change it. And at some point of time, it does get changed. Yeah, fine, we hear you kind of thing, and we change it. So I think it's a matter of, design has to take the voice of the user perspective, that I mean, designing objects and boxes and all of that is one part. But when you say it's not about all of that, but it's about being for the user, then I think it changes. When you bring your CEO to meet some user, when you actually have a user kind of a group and you say, hey, why don't you watch from outside? Why don't you sit at the next table, drink your coffee and just overhear the conversation? I think part of it is that. I think that's when you convert. And again, if you have good CEOs. So for example, thankfully, the founder, chairman of MakeMyTrip, Deep Kalra, is a fairly mature and sensible guy who's been around for years. You might have much more younger kind of upstarts who will say, this is my way, kind of, I'm 20-something and I'm kind of doing it this way. This is my way or the highway kind of thing. You might have it. I think age gives you that maturity as well, hopefully, to listen to things kind of. So yeah, you will have different people, but you need to keep sustaining it. You need to keep doing it. So my boss tells me that my greatest achievement in the 2 years at MakeMyTrip has been that in most major meetings, people will use the word cognitive overload. I said, that's good then. That's something, it's kind of sinking in kind of thing. They will probably say cognitive overload, so maybe let's not do that kind of thing. So that's not So PMs have got it, devs have got it, marketing has got it. First they'll say, what is cognitive overload kind of thing, and then they get it kind of thing. So yeah, that's, hope that answers.
So we have one more question from Arvind. Here you go, Arvind.
Hi, my name is Arvind. That was a great session. I really liked it. So there's one thing that people encounter in their company, right? You spoke about designing without borders. Right?
Yeah.
So there are some borders that are actually imposed by things outside the designer's control, right? The company policies, their marketing strategies, or their goals as such, right? So say, for example, you give too much options to the client, then the business may not grow. So you want to restrict them. So you control them with a design that the user don't like, but then it improves the business, right? So how do designers address those kind of borders or boundaries?
Sure. I think if I understood you right, that there are other borders which are good. And that's what exactly I was saying, that there are certain borders which are very good. Keep them that way. Like borders that you impose on yourself, that maybe I'll give just two options, not three. But those three options or two options have to be very well thought out before I need to play it out in my head. I need to almost get in the user's shoes, the client's shoes, and then play that out. There are other borders, like I will not do because of health. I will not do this because it's unethical, which you probably talked about. I will not make things which are super addictive. I will not make things which are like, which you get lost into. I'll draw my border at maybe dark patterns. So I think there are a bunch of borders that you need to do. But the idea here is that don't get too stuck in borders that you should be breaking. So remember, recognize the borders that should be there and should not be there. Because the borders which should not be there, you kind of almost grow into it. You don't even notice that they exist sometimes. So break those, but keep these. So I think that's probably a call for, I think, more reflective practice, more thoughtful practice. Like what I was showing you about that bullet train was extremely thoughtful practice. You have thought through like so many layers right out kind of thing, right? You've thought of so many people, you've thought of so many different things. That's the level of practice that you should think about. And you say, maybe that's not my job, but someone has to do it because that's right for the user kind of. So that's probably where it comes from. Thank you.
Thanks, Jay. So we have one last question. There you go.
Hi, I'm Preeta from Future Funds. I just have a quick question. It's sort of similar to the previous question. When you say designing without borders, when there's a larger value chain in a company where you said exactly where there's an audience, where there's a B2B business, and then there's a B2C, and there's a long value chain, how do you design for different stakeholders when you know the language is different for each of these? How do you go about addressing it as a design head? How do you do that?
Great. I think the question was around when it's not your domain, when it's different people, how do you make that happen? How do you make design happen? Because there are too many stakeholders across. I think partly you realize that you are part of a much larger system. Designers at one point, I still think in many places, we feel that we are the center of the universe. We are not. We are just cogs in the wheel, just like everyone else is. You realize that even, so this was this, I'll digress a little bit. Yuval Noah Harari talking about power. So he talks about the fact that the most powerful people, if you think about it, the kind of the English monarchs or maybe the Mughal emperors or so on and so forth, they would go with great courts, great pomp and show. They can chop off anyone's heads off. But actually, they are the least powerful. They show a lot of power, but they don't have that much power. The more powerful ones, the Putins and whoever of the world, because they have a hand on the nuclear button, and that could like do with very minor thing, they can just annihilate so much more. But they don't have a pomp and show of power. They dress as normal common people. They dress, they go as normal as possible kind of thing, right? In the same way, what you realize is, but they cannot. They just can't put that hand on the button. Even a Kim Jong-un can't put the hand on the button. Even this hand is very close, because you're always, you realize however powerful you are, you're always kind of caught in so many stakeholder situations, kind of, right? So many expectations, so many other sort of bindings. Same for us. We have a whole lot of things. There are things we cannot do, and there are things which are not in our control. We have to find sort of people who can do it for us, do it with us. I think that's the fun of it, when your learning and your network grows. You find something, you find maybe some interesting problem for those paradoxes, and you realize that I need to solve that, but I can't solve it by myself. Maybe I need to find collaborators. And suddenly you need, it grows. Like a good example, again, Naresh Narasimhan, who was talking about, there was this steel flyover which came up a few years ago. By individually, we can't do much, but as a collective, we got together, we had some 10,000 people lining the street, we went out on the protest, we said, hey, what if we made a drone footage of this whole thing and actually showed how many trees will be lost? And that was the power of visual design, you might say. Someone did it. It was one of us kind of thing, right? And we showed a drone photograph of like the Cubbon Park and all those golf course and everything. It's so beautiful, and it touches you, and you say, wow, this shall not be lost. So another 10,000 people joined in. Now, these are things that you find, that these are the collaborators. If it's almost like what Gandhi used to say, you find the cause and you will find the people will follow. It's something like that probably. But find the cause. I think we're not finding enough causes. That's the thing. No more questions then?
I guess we're up with time, so that will be the last question.
Yeah.
Anyways, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Jay, for the amazing session and patiently answering.
Thank you.